What are you thankful for? If you're not able to rattle off a list yet, I would give you a friendly reminder that you don't have much time, just a few days until Thanksgiving Day comes this Thursday. Really, we should be able to, at any given moment, come up with a plethora of things that we're thankful for, not just on one day of the year, but every day. So again, I would ask, what are you thankful for? The Bible tells us that God has provided us with so much for which to thank Him for. Out of everything that I could list for you, there's one spiritual blessing that's been on my mind and my heart for a number of weeks now. And that spiritual blessing is called redemption. Indeed, redemption is actually the theme of the entire Bible. But there is one passage in particular I want us to zero in on this morning to direct your attention to as we open God's Word, and this passage centers on redemption. You can find this passage in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. I'm going to read that for you. Actually, I'm going to read verse 7 and then just the first part of verse 8 for us this morning. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace, which He lavished upon us. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord endures forever. Amen. Redemption has been defined as the deliverance or release of any possession, object, or person by payment of a ransom. Redemption is not a word that's unique only to Christianity. It was a term typically used in the Apostle Paul's day for warfare or in especially slave trading. Prisoners of war could be redeemed back to their armies through a ransom or an exchange. Slaves could be redeemed from their slavery and their debts by a redeemer who would pay for them entirely, or he would pay off their debts in full. The Ephesian believers would have known about redemption as it relates to slavery. At the time that this letter was written to them, it's estimated that there were around 60 million slaves across the Roman Empire. Maybe some of these Ephesian believers knew someone who was a slave. Perhaps they themselves had been slaves at one point, or upon receiving and reading this letter, they were still slaves under the Roman Empire. They would have understood the basic concept of redemption to mean the purchase or deliverance of one from a situation in which they were powerless to liberate themselves from, or for which the penalty was just too expensive that they had no hope of paying the ransom fee. Paul uses this well-known word, redemption, and he applies it to a person's spiritual state and situation. Implicit in this teaching of redemption is the fact that as sinful, fallen people, we cannot redeem ourselves from the power and the penalty of sin, our slavery to Satan or to the system of this world government, as well as the condemning word of the law of God that's looming over us for our transgression of it. So just like a prisoner of war or like a slave in the Roman Empire, we were helplessly, hopelessly enslaved to sin and under God's just condemnation for our transgressions. And amazingly, the gospel teaches us that God did something for us that we could never do for ourselves. He redeemed us sinners from our slavery to sin, Satan, and this world system through His beloved Son, Jesus Christ, according to His magnificent, infinite grace. Redemption. What a blessing to be thankful for. And that's what we need to do. We need to be thankful for redemption, and that's our theme this morning. Be thankful for redemption through Jesus Christ. My objective this morning is rather straightforward. A desire to stir our hearts up with gratitude for our most gracious Redeemer and for the redemption that we have in Him. In order to accomplish this objective, I want us to break down Ephesians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, almost word by word, going through seven features of redemption that we can behold and can thank God for today. Yes, you heard that right. There is a 7-point outline for you to fill in this morning, which means we're not going to be able to dwell very much in depth on each feature. Rather, this is going to be a short survey of redemption, but hopefully it's enough to stir our hearts up with gratitude for the Lord. That being said, feature number one, be thankful for the purchaser of redemption. This is found in the first two words of verse 7. In Him we have redemption. Who this purchaser is identified in the context of the preceding verses. In Him is directly related to the one called Beloved in verse 6. And this Beloved can be traced all the way back to verse 3 and called by name our Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 3, Paul explains there that God the Father has blessed all believers in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. All spiritual blessings are found in Jesus Christ, God's Son. And therefore, redemption, which is most assuredly a spiritual blessing, is a Christ-centered blessing, wrapped up in Jesus Christ. This is why Christ came to earth in the first place. Paul says of Jesus Christ in 1 Corinthians 1:30, Christ Jesus became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification, and redemption. And elsewhere in Galatians, Paul wrote, But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And also, if you were to do a word study of this name or title, Redeemer, just in the book of Isaiah, you'd find many times where the Lord is called the Redeemer, followed with one of the following titles, Holy One of Israel, the King of Israel, or the Lord of Hosts, or the Lord your Maker. All of these names and titles rightfully belong to Jesus Christ. Redemption is Christ's. It originates in Christ. He's the one who's accomplished it, paid for it. He owns it. Redemption resides in Christ alone. Jesus Christ is the purchaser of redemption. We'll never fully appreciate the greatness of redemption until we appreciate the greatness of the Redeemer. Yes, be thankful for those blessings that you enjoy in redemption. But even more so, enjoy the grandeur of Jesus Christ, the purchaser of that blessed redemption. Consider all that Jesus is, all that He's done, all that He will do and will be to you, just because He is the purchaser of your redemption. There is a Redeemer, Jesus Christ, God's Son. So be thankful for this purchaser of redemption. Feature number two, be thankful for the objects of redemption. This is found in the very next word in verse 7. In Him we have redemption. Here we see that the objects of redemption are a specific people group. Who are these specific people? Again, the context of these surrounding verses in Ephesians 1 help us to find out specifically in verses 3 to 14 will really suffice in identifying who these people are. In verse 3, these people are all who are blessed with every spiritual blessing. In verse 4, they are all who were chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. In verse 5, they are all who were predestined for adoption through Christ. In verse 6, they are all who are blessed or accepted in the Beloved. In verse 7, as we'll see in a few moments, they are all who are forgiven of their trespasses. In verse 9, they are all who know the mystery of God's will. In verse 11, they are all who have obtained an inheritance in Christ. In verse 12, they are all who hope in Christ. In verse 13, they are all who hear and believe the word of truth. And in verse 14, they are all who are sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. In short, this specific people group, who are the objects of this redemption, are all who have placed their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Redemption is enjoyed by those who are in Christ Jesus. Outside of and apart from Jesus Christ, You cannot experience or enjoy the blessing of redemption. It's only for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you're a believer in the Lord here this morning or watching online, then verses 3 through 14 of Ephesians 1 describes your identity in Christ. You're blessed in Christ, chosen in Christ, predestined in Christ for adoption, accepted in Christ, forgiven in Christ. You know God's mystery of the gospel revealed in Christ. You have an inheritance in Christ. You have faith in Christ. You are sealed with the Spirit of Christ. This is who you are as an object of Christ's redemption. This is what you get to enjoy. As a believer, you are included in the select group of people, a specific people who enjoy specific privileges, exclusive privileges in Jesus Christ. You are Christ's redeemed. Be thankful that God has included you among this number of this specific redeemed people. Thank Him that you are an object of Christ's redemption. Feature number 3, be thankful for the certainty of redemption. This feature is represented in the verb immediately following the objects of redemption in verse 7. In Him we have redemption. The work of redemption spoken of here is a blessing that is possessed by the believer. Think about the certainty of redemption as it relates to time. Redemption is a certainty with regard to the past. Revelation 13:8 says that Christ is the Lamb who was slain from the foundation of the world. And in Hebrews, the author says, His works were finished from the foundation of the world. So, redemption is a certainty as regard to the past. It's also a certainty with regard to the future. Jesus, after teaching about the signs that are going to precede His second coming in glory and power, He says in Luke 21:28, Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. And then Paul, in Romans 8:23, of this future redemption, he writes, We wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. This is a redemption that's happening, or going to happen, rather, in the future for the believer. And yet, redemption is also a certainty with regard to the present. The verb that's used here in Ephesians 1:7 is in the present tense. The present tense indicates a durative action, so that the phrase could be paraphrased accurately like this: In Him we are continually having redemption, or we have and are still having redemption. It's as if the redemption that Christ has purchased for us is now the very air in which we Christians live, move, and have our being. For the believer, redemption is an abiding certainty, past, future, but also present. Redemption is a present, eternal blessing for the Christian. Right now and forevermore, the redeemed possess redemption in Jesus Christ. Because redemption is a work that's rooted in Christ in eternity past, before the foundations of the world, because it's a work that has abiding consequences in the here and now through the application of the Holy Spirit upon our hearts, and because it's a work that's promised to be finalized in a time to be revealed in future glory, redemption is a blessing that the redeemed will never and can never lose. We have no need to fear that the purchaser of redemption will one day return us back to our former condition and master. Redemption has been designed in such a way that it crosses all dimensions of time. It's arranged from eternity past, accomplished at the cross, applied by the Holy Spirit to our hearts, and is an inheritance that's imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for us, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Be thankful that once you're redeemed, you cannot lose your redemption or be returned by your Redeemer. It's an abiding, present, eternal certainty to those who are in Christ Jesus. Feature number 4, be thankful for the price of redemption. And this, I believe, is why redemption is so certain for us who believe. Examine this next phrase of verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood. Remember our definition of redemption. It is deliverance or release of a slave or prisoner by payment of a ransom. We're told here now how the purchaser, Jesus Christ, made us sinners the objects of this certain redemption. It was by means of a blood ransom, a blood payment. Think for a moment about the significance of Christ's blood. His blood represents his life sacrificed to make an atonement for our sins. Leviticus 17:11 tells us, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it for you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement by the life." And then again in Mark's gospel, Jesus taught this very same thing about why he came. "For even the Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many." So Christ's blood, his death, in other words, was the penalty price, the ransom payment to free enslaved sinners. Also consider that Christ's blood is human blood. Hebrews 2 records, "Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he," that is Christ himself, "likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Therefore, he had to be made like his brothers in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of the people." It was man who owed the blood price to God, this debt to God for sin, so only man's blood could be offered. Thus, the significance of Christ taking on flesh in the incarnation. And yet, we also know from the Bible that Christ's blood is also divine. Paul, speaking to the Ephesian elders in Acts chapter 20, says, "Shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood." It was man's debt to pay to God, but man was unable to pay it because it would be an unsatisfactory payment tainted with sin. But God was able to make this debt payment that man owed, but he was not required to pay it to himself. Thus, the incarnation involves this grand conundrum. Jesus Christ, fully man, yet fully God, could pay the debt, and it would be satisfactory because he is totally righteous. His blood is pure and untainted by sin. Because his blood is divine, it has infinite merit. It has omnipotent power, and it's completely efficacious to accomplish redemption to the fullest degree. To this truth, Jesus cried out from the cross in some of his last words, "It is finished." When someone had a debt to pay in ancient times, and it was paid off, they would write the Greek word tetelestai on that certificate, which means paid in full, the exact words that Jesus declares in his moment of ultimate triumph over Satan and sin from the cross. Tetelestai was used by various people in everyday life in those days. For example, receipts for taxes found in secular Greek writings have found written across them on the top this single Greek word, tetelestai. It's a good document to have when the auditor would come around. Good document to have, especially when the divine auditor comes around. When a Roman citizen, for example, was convicted of crime, the law of that day would slam that person in prison, and they would prepare a certificate of debt that would be attached to their cell, listing all the crimes that they're convicted of for all to see. It remained nailed there on that person's cell so that all would be assured that he served his full sentence and paid in full the penalty for his crimes. When Jesus, dying for us on that awful cross, announced his great victory cry with this Greek word, tetelestai, it would have resonated with many who are watching this spectacle, for it was a very familiar phrase to them. Tetelestai was the same word that the authorities would stamp across a certificate of debt after a criminal had completed his prison term. It literally meant that they had paid in full for all of their crimes. Then the criminal was given that certificate, which he could produce to show at any moment that his debts and obligations really had been paid in full. This is what Christ's blood has done. Additionally, we're told in Scripture that Christ's blood is eternal. 1 Peter 1, 18-20. His blood gives peace. Colossians 1, 19-20. And his blood draws sinners near to God, Ephesians 2:13, and his blood grants sinners access into the most holy places to stand before God, Hebrews 10:19-22. Overall, redemption through Christ's blood emphasizes not only who we are in Christ, but whose we are. Paul writes in several places, as well as the Apostle Peter, "You are not your own. For you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body. Christ gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works." And Peter writes, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." So, be thankful that Jesus paid it all on the cross at the cost of his own life, at the cost of his blood, making you his own possession in the process. And that brings me to this fifth feature. Be thankful for the result of redemption. Now look at the next clause in verse 7. "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses." Jesus Christ, the purchaser of certain redemption by his blood ransom, made sinners the objects of his redemption, resulting in the forgiveness of their sins. Forgiveness was purchased for us by the blood of Jesus Christ. Forgiveness. It's a word that we throw around just as much as redemption or salvation without really giving it much of a second thought. The word forgiveness literally depicts a sending away or a putting away of something or the release from something which binds and oppresses, such as chains, debt, or tribute. The root of this word forgiveness means to put away an offense. In Greek culture, this word forgiveness was used as a legal term that meant to repay or cancel a debt or to grant a lawbreaker full pardon. Jesus, in Matthew chapter 18, told a parable of this king who forgives a servant a vast amount of debt, freeing this man from prison in order to return to his family and life. Of course, we do know that the servant does abuse the king's forgiveness, but the sentiment of forgiveness there is still there for us to see. In the Old Testament, in Leviticus 16, the transgressions of Israel would be forgiven, removed from them entirely through what was called a scapegoat. The high priest was to take a goat, lay both of his hands upon that goat's head, confess over it the iniquities of the people, all their transgressions, all of their sins, and then send that goat away into the wilderness to bear all of the people's transgressions off to this remote area where this goat would never be seen ever again. It's very symbolic. And Psalm 103 offers us another beautiful picture of what God does when he forgives us of sin. Psalm 103, 10-12, "God does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us." The picture here is of the extent of God's forgiveness. It's limitless. Or take Isaiah 43:25. The Lord says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. Here are the pictures of God erasing the record of transgressions. He doesn't simply use whiteout on each of our sins. He actually removes the transgression from the record as if it never existed. In Christ, because of the payment and application of his blood, we stand before God as if we were Christ, all because Christ stood before God as if he were us. What are we to say about this great reversal, this great removal of transgressions? I think the words from Micah 7:18 seem to be fitting. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in steadfast love. Be thankful today that through the shedding of Christ's blood, he took your sins upon himself and carried its penalty and power an infinite distance away, never to be seen again. Thank Jesus for being your scapegoat, for being the object of God's wrath for your transgressions, so that you can be an object of redemption, resulting in the forgiveness of your trespasses. You've been forgiven of all past sins, forgiven of all present sins, and forgiven of any future sins. Christ has cast them into the depths of the sea. He's blotted them out from his record. He's not going to charge them to our account. They've been purged, and he remembers them no more. Be thankful for this result of redemption. The sixth feature of redemption, be thankful for the source of redemption. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace. I needn't say too much about grace. We're all familiar that it's the unmerited, undeserved favor, love, kindness, and goodness of God freely given to us. And the meaning of grace is easy enough for us to remember when we put it like this. Grace is God's redemption at Christ's expense. Or, G stands for gift, which is the principle of grace. R stands for redemption, which is the purpose of grace. A stands for access, which is the privilege of grace. C stands for Christ, who is the person of grace, and E stands for eternal life, which is the product of grace. By grace, God planned redemption. By grace, God provided redemption. By grace, Christ performed redemption. By grace, the Spirit applies redemption. By grace, God will complete redemption in the final resurrection. And by God's grace, it will be to the praise of his glorious grace. Redemption is the free gift of God's grace. You can't earn redemption. You couldn't win redemption. You couldn't provide it for yourself. You can't secure it for yourself. You can't finish it for yourself. Redemption from start to finish is entirely the work of God's grace. Be thankful for God's grace that grants you redemption so freely when you didn't and still don't deserve it. Now there's one more feature, a seventh feature of redemption I'd like to show you in the first part of verse 8. Be thankful for the measure of redemption. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us. How much have we been forgiven? What's the extent, the measurement, the scope of this certain gracious redemption that we have in Christ through his blood? Paul writes in the last phrase of verse 7, it's according to the riches of his grace. When Paul uses this preposition, according to, he does not mean that redemption comes out of just a portion of the riches of God's grace. No, according to actually means proportionate to. Put a little differently, Paul is saying that redemption resulting in our forgiveness does not come out of God's riches, but is proportionate to God's riches. Allow me to illustrate this point, hopefully to instill it a little clearer in your minds. If you were to go to a billionaire and you were to ask him to contribute to a worthy cause, and he gave you a $20 bill, he would only be giving you out of his riches. Many poor people are able to give a $20 bill to a charitable cause. But if, instead, this billionaire gave you a check for $20 million, then this billionaire would be giving according to, in proportion to, his riches. That's just a small picture of God's generosity to us. Redemption and forgiveness is given according to, in proportion to, the riches of his grace. Additionally, Paul says that God bestows this blessing lavishly upon us. We need never worry that our sin is ever going to outstrip God's gracious redemption and forgiveness. This word lavished is really a beautiful word that occurs in the New Testament several times. One commentator paraphrases this particular verse like this: "In Christ we're having redemption through his blood, the putting away of our trespasses according to the wealth of his grace, which he caused to superabound to us." Paul uses the same word twice in Romans chapter 5 within just a span of a few verses. First in Romans 5:15, and then again in verse 20, Paul writes, "But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many." And then in verse 20, "Now the law came to increase the trespass, but where sin abounded, grace superabounded." Ann Flint, the writer of one of the hymns that I posted last week, I believe, in your outline, has another hymn with a stanza that goes, "His love has no limit, his grace has no measure, his power has no boundary known unto men. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again." God does not give us a redemption and a forgiveness that barely pays the ransom, that barely covers our sins or offenses. Sin made us beggars to God eternally. But God's grace makes us rich in Christ. Be thankful that God's grace knows no bounds. It's not limited. He's not a penny pincher. He isn't frugal in giving us redemption and forgiveness. In Christ and through Christ, God spares no expense. He goes all out. Thank God today that he gives according to, in proportion to, his infinite superabounding grace. To wrap up this little survey of redemption, I think it would be fitting for us to hear Jesus' own words on what redemption has accomplished for us. In the Gospel of John, chapter 8, verses 34 to 36, Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you'll be free indeed." In short, redemption in Christ means freedom. And freedom given by Christ and in Christ is the only true freedom. Redemption emphasizes three essential truths. Firstly, people are by nature slaves to sin. That's who everyone is outside of Christ. Our situation was one of helplessness and hopelessness. We were not able to redeem ourselves. Secondly, Christ paid the price for freedom. Our redemption and freedom demanded a high price we could never pay. The price was proportionate to the redemption we required. Mankind had sinned infinitely against God to the uttermost. Therefore, Christ gave himself to the uttermost, that we would experience and enjoy redemption through his blood to the uttermost. And thirdly, the redeemed are free. Believers live in freedom. The price that was paid in full to release us from our bondage to sin and death was Christ's blood. For freedom, Christ has set us free. We're now free to live as we ought to live, not as slaves to sin, but as slaves to righteousness, for the glory of God and the enjoyment of Him now in this world and in eternity to come. Let our thanksgiving today and this week abound more and more to the glory of God for redemption through Jesus Christ. Be thankful that Christ is your Redeemer. Be thankful that you're an object of His redemption. Be thankful that you can be certain you have His redemption. Be thankful for the blood ransom of this redemption. Be thankful for the result of redemption, the forgiveness of your trespasses. Be thankful for this source of redemption, God's grace. And be thankful for this infinite measure of grace, a well that never runs dry, a fountain that never stops flowing, a love that never fails. Today and this week, be thankful for redemption in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. O Lord, redemption, what a blessing. What a full and meaningful word to us who believe. Because you have freed us, we are free to live for you. We're free to thank you all of our days, free to glorify you as our Redeemer. Jesus, we thank you for the redemption that comes only through you. Amen.